My name is Dr. Raymond Sorrells. This is Titus Baptist Bible College, and we welcome you here. This will be the homiletics class. Homiletics class will last 8 weeks, and it'll be 2 30-minute segments a night, and we'll cover as much as material as we can. We'll have some exams in the middle of 8 weeks, maybe in fourth week. We'll have exams, then the 8th week we'll have a final. And this cover this book I put together, God allowed me to put together on homiletics. It's about preaching. And then we have another textbook. This textbook is The Preacher and His Preaching by A.P. Gibbs. Now, something you need to understand, this textbook here is only for homework. And you have to read this book. In the next 8 weeks, this book has to be read in its entirety. And I have homework here. This homework you've already received in your packet. And it's based on this book here, this Preacher and His Preaching. It's easy. The questions in it, chapter by chapter, paragraph by paragraph. The only reason that I have homework and study questions, and I may not assign these study questions to you every week. I'll assign you homework each week. But the reason I do this is to be assured that you're going to read the book. It's important that you read this book. And at the end of the 8 weeks, you send this back in. I want you to look at your homiletic homework, and I want you to look at lesson one. This is how we'll do it. It says, read chapter one, the qualification of preacher. And then it says, answer study questions which relate to chapter one. This week, we're not going to answer the questions. And lesson two says, read chapter two. I'll assign you one or two chapters, or three or four, as much as we need to get it done in 8 weeks. And what I want you to do, I want you to come out right over that, and I want you to write on that on time or late. Now, I want you to be honest, because most of you are preachers anyway, and if you are dishonest with this, then next time you preach, God's going to bring that to your attention, and then you won't be able to preach as well if you lie on this. So I'm sure you won't do that. So every week, when I assign your homework, if you do it by the next week lesson, put on time. If for some reason you can't, well, then you put late. And what this is, this will count as a third of your grade. There are 25 lessons on here. That's 4 points per lesson. Now, if you get it late, that's 2 points off of that. So you can make 100 on this, and that's a third of your grade. So it's important that you do this, and it'll count just like a test. And it may even be your midterm test. So be sure and do this. And don't have to worry about the questions and answers in the Preacher and the Preaching book. The answers are right there. As I said in the beginning, that this is homiletics class. Homiletics is another word like hermeneutics. It's a practical theology. Practical theology simply means I take what I know, what I've learned, doctrine, Bible, experiences, things that I've learned over the years, or things that I'm learning now, or things that I might learn later, and learn how to put those things into practice. You know a lot of things and not know how to use it, it won't do you any good. These classes here, like homiletics, hermeneutics, pastoral theology, church administration, church business, these things are practical theology. It's the things that deal with God, but how to put things into practice. Now, you can have all the knowledge in the world and not know how to do something, and you wouldn't get the job done. And so this class here is not teaching you how to preach. If God doesn't call you to preach, if God doesn't make you a preacher, we certainly cannot do that. We have no intention to major on style. We have no intention doing that. I'm not going to try to teach you what style or how you should preach and your delivery, how you present the message. I can't do that. God has to do that. God has different people to preach to different people in different ways at different times. You might see people that you like and you enjoy hearing preach, and you might for a while unintentionally preach like them, but eventually God's going to settle you down and you're going to be preaching like God wants you to preach. And it's not like somebody else. If God wanted you to preach like someone else, He wouldn't have called you. He called you to be who you are. Many years ago, I was preaching as a young preacher in a church in Cincinnati, Ohio. And as I come out, I must have said something. I must have shown arrogance or something. I don't remember. But as I come out of that church there, the biggest church I'd ever preached in, and I probably felt pretty good about myself. And when I come out, an old preacher said this. It's helped me through my preaching years. And he said this. It wasn't grammatically correct, but it sure was profound. And he said, Brother Sorrows, don't try to be something you ain't. If you do, you're going to mess up what you is. And so I practiced that from then on, the best of my ability. I promised God that I was going to be just what I am. May not be liked by a lot of folks, but just be what you are. Preach the gospel, preach it the way the Bible said, and the way God allowed you. Now, I said we weren't going to look at style, but there are some mannerisms in the Bible that, in the pulpit that I don't think you ought to do. First of all, and this is just me, I don't think you ought to preach with your hand in your pocket. To me, little things like that distract, you know, you seem like you don't care about it. And a lot of people do that, but I'm just one of those guys sitting in a congregation that I don't like it. And so refrain from anything like that. And there are some other mannerisms you need to, without getting in style, that I'm going to mention here. You don't need to be picking your nose. You don't need to be scratching. You don't need to be doing things like that would distract you. Many years ago, I heard a great preacher in Tabernacle. And he's a great preacher. He's in heaven now, but a great preacher. Famous in the world for preaching. And the only thing I remember that whole sermon is the man scratched his nose the whole time. And that kind of thing draws your attention away from the gospel message. And so without getting into too much into style and that sort of thing, just be careful how you act in the pulpit. Well, this class is going to be more about the practical, outlining what a preacher should be, how he should act, things that he should do, things that he should not do, how to prepare for a message, how to assimilate the material, how to saturate yourself with that material, and then finally how to present that material to a congregation. I believe in my heart that you, if you're God called, that you can preach without going to school. You can preach without taking this course here. And maybe have a successful ministry without ever taking homiletics, without ever even knowing what it means. You probably, if you're God called, you've got to touch God on you. If power of God is on you, you're probably going to do all right, even if you didn't even ever heard of homiletics. But if you're not called of God, if God has not touched you and called you to preach the gospel, you take this course 10 times and you won't ever have a ministry with God's hand on it if you're not God's call. Having said this, that I'll say this. I believe that this course will help you and help you get the job done quicker. I believe education helps you cut a lot of corners that you'd have to take you 20 years to learn some things that you'll learn in these 8 weeks by yourself out there in a school of higher knots. It's going to take you a lot longer to learn it, and it'll be a lot harder in learning it. It's difficult to learn it the hard way. For instance, in pastoral theology that we'll be covering the next 8 weeks, when I got out of Bible school, I went straight to the mission field, out of Bible college. Never had baptized anybody, never given the Lord's Supper. But when I got there, they expected me to be an experienced pastor. And they had some folks getting saved, and they had 16 people there for me to baptize. They were waiting for me to get there because I knew how to do it. I'd never baptized anybody in my life. And so there I was. I had the knowledge, but I didn't know how to do it. I didn't know practically how to do it. And that's what we try to do in these practical courses. And when you get somewhere, believe it or not, if you're brand new and you go somewhere and they call you as a pastor, or if you go preach a meeting somewhere, they really expect you to know what you're doing. For some reason or another, they think you ought to know. And it'd be good to know as much as you can. And so without having to learn it with them, some things you're going to learn over the years, but the greatest thing is to go through this course and try to learn these things now. Well, this is, like I said, a homiletic class. The definition of homiletical is to converse in company. Now, I guess that means that if I'm preaching in the car, and I do a lot of preaching in the car, I prepare a lot of my messages all by myself, and I preach to myself alone sometimes. You just need to be careful stopping the red light doing that. People looking at you, and you over there preaching, they're thinking a little something's wrong with you. But that's not being homiletical. According to the definition, homiletical is conversing in company. That's why we want to have people when we preach, and we want people to be listening to what we say. So when you're conversing in company, then you will be homiletical. Now, I mentioned practical, and I wrote down here the definition for practical: that which may be used in practice, that which may be applied to use as practical knowledge. Now, you've got the intellect, you've got the knowledge, now you need practical knowledge and things you need to do. God showed me this not too long ago. I was preaching, and God spoke to my heart and made me think of the scripture that says, "Now then, we are sons of God." And as I was preaching, it dawned on me that I was speaking as a son of God. My pastor, Brother Ricky Emery, says this: when his children leave home, he tells them, "Remember who you are." And that's important for us to remember. So God was telling me when I was preaching that day and reminding me that I was a son of God, God was telling me, "Remember who you are." So you get in the pulpit, as a son of God. Now that's an important position to be in, to be speaking about the Father as a son of God. As I'm preaching, another thought come to my mind. Not only am I a son of God, and I'm proud of that and glad of that, and rejoice in the fact that I am a son of God, but this thought came to me: not only am I a son of God, I'm preaching to sons of God. And so, on the most part, there's lost people in every congregation, probably more than we ever think. But there are sons of God there. And I need to present myself as a son of God, and I need to preach to them as they are sons of God. This is a thought that came to my mind, that when my brother and I was growing up, my dad would never, I would never tell my brother to clean up his room or to feed the dog or anything. If I told him that, he wouldn't listen to me, a brother talking to a brother. And so he would never listen to that. But if I went and told him, "Dad said, clean up your room," now that gave it a little bit more power. That gave it a little bit more strength. And usually, if my brother believes me, then he obeyed that command that I gave him from my father. And that's the same way with us preachers. They're our brethren. I'm talking to my brothers. And you're my brother I'm talking to today. Well, I'm talking to you as a son of God, and I'm trying to tell you some things that my father told me to tell you. So when you're preaching, you're a brother talking to a brother, but you're telling them what the Father said. And I remember telling my brother, "Marvin, if you don't do that, you know what Dad's going to do." And Dad said, "Do it, and you better hurry up and do it." And he told me to tell you to do it. And he said, "Not make him have to come over here." And so that's the way it is preaching. we need to put a force behind it, because it's important that our brethren hear what we're saying, what the Father told us to tell them, because we don't want the wrath of God to come. And so remember that when you're preaching, that you're not just preaching as somebody that's standing up there preaching, but you're preaching as a son of God, and you are preaching to sons of God. On this book here that you had, that you got before you, these are my notes. You got exactly what I've got. And so you don't have to take notes much, unless maybe I say something, and I do on occasion, that's not in the book. But what I try to do is go back and put it in the book if I do that. But if I do, there's a blank page right across from every lesson. You can just write the notes in there. But on this book, on the front, I got a picture of Spurgeon. Spurgeon is the prince of preachers. I read a lot behind Spurgeon. Spurgeon was a great man of God and preached with the power of God on him. I'm going to read you a quote that I've got on the front of this book that I put here. And it says, "Today there's not very much gospel about." Now, I wonder, that's the death, burial, and the resurrection. I can't help from thinking what if Spurgeon was here in 2010. In the late 1800s, around 1880 and 1890s, when he said this, I think, can you imagine if he said that the gospel had about gone, then what would Spurgeon be saying now? If he saw the need for preaching then, the gospel, what would he see now? He said the church had given it up. I heard a preacher say not too long ago that preaching won't get the job done anymore. And can I tell you something, man? If preaching won't get the job done, we just fold it up and go now. Because if preaching won't get it done, won't anything get it done. God uses the preaching of the Word of God to get the job done. And he said even in this time, the church has given up preaching the gospel. Said a great many preachers preach everything but living truth. This is sad, but it is a strong reason why you and I should teach and preach the gospel more than ever. We're not to get discouraged when other folks aren't doing it. That should encourage us to preach more of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Spurgeon said, "I've often thought to myself, other men teach socialism, deliver lectures, and I found this amusing, or collect a band of fiddlers." Well, I guess that was a hang-up with Spurgeon. He didn't want churches having fiddlers in his day. Anyway, we'll pass on that. What he was saying, it's all maybe all right to have some things in there, but nothing to take the place of preaching. That they may gather a congregation, see. And what he was saying, don't do these things together, congregation. If preaching won't bring in a congregation, whatever brings in, somebody down the street's going to do something more and get you folks. He said, "But I will preach the gospel. I will preach more gospel than ever if I can. I will stick more to the carnal point." And that is the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the man that said this, and we got another paragraph here, but the man that said this gave out tickets for his congregation which Sunday they could come to church, so it had room for his visitors to come. Now, his members couldn't come every Sunday because he wanted lost people in there, and he preached to tens of thousands without a microphone, and he said, "I'm just going to stick to preaching." And how important preaching is. He says this is real strong. I wouldn't say this in a preacher's fellowship if I was you. It says, "The other brethren can attend to the odds and ends, but I will keep to Christ and Him crucified." He said, let them preach the odds and ends. Don't worry about what they're doing. He said, "To the men of vast ability who are looking to the events of the day, I would say, allow one poor fool to keep to preaching the gospel. Beloved teachers, be fools for Christ and keep to the gospel. Don't be afraid of the gospel. Don't be afraid of this book." He says it has life in it. We have a lively hope, not a dead hope, but a lively hope. Heard a preacher say one time that sometime we confuse dignity with rigor mortis. And again, not to get into style, but I am getting into style. One thing I would encourage you not to do is to get too dignified to the point where you'll be boring. You don't want to do that because you want to keep the attention of your congregation. So be sure to do that. If you believe it has life in it, it will grow. Anything that has life, it will grow. But you have to let it grow. You have to get up there and let the gospel do its work. Don't ever doubt what the Word of God can do. Once you get in a congregation and begin to preach, there's something you need to remember. Homiletics is that science of theology which helps us to adapt our preaching to our congregation where they get a better understanding. Now, I put this in here, and when I read that, it doesn't just sound just right to me, because I'm one of those guys that was raised as I don't adapt my preaching to anybody. I'm going to preach it, amen, and when I get through preaching it, they can take it or leave it, and that's the way I came up. But if you'll stop and think about adapting your message to the congregation you're in. I pastored a church with a Bible college in it and also a day school. Now, when I preached to the Bible college, I didn't preach the same way I did the first graders. Now, I can say I don't adapt my preaching all I want to, but when I preach to Bible college students, I can't give them what I give the first graders, and I can't give the first graders to what I gave the Bible college students. So I do, in reality, adapt my message, and homiletics will teach you how to do that, because you can't adapt to one group of people because you're in a church setting and leave the other people out. Homiletics will teach you how to involve everyone. There's an outline that just come across my mind. That to have a successful ministry, it has to be extensive enough to reach everyone and inclusive enough to include everyone. You can't leave anybody out. You say, well, I'm going to preach a salvation message. That's wonderful. But you need to feed the flock. Well, I'm going to feed the flock. That's wonderful. But you got lost people here. And I believe this course will help you balance that and be a more balanced preacher by taking this course. Every time we preach, there's three different kind of people sitting in our congregation, and we have to take into account these three folks. One of them, these folks, are spiritual men. And when I come to church to preach, I need to realize that there's folks out there that's spiritual. And they, some of them may be closer to God than I am. And some of them may have more knowledge of the Word of God than I have. And when I go there, I realize that's one group of people that I've got to feed. I've got to give them something. They're in my congregation. Preachers, don't ever preach down to your congregation. Don't ever say, you don't understand this. That's a bad thing to say. Or, I don't know what you do, but I do this. And talk about them not praying and then tell them how much you pray. And talk to them about not studying and then tell them how much you study. Don't preach down to your people, because remember, they are sons of God, just like you are a son of God, and you need to treat them that way. Tell them what the Father said, not what you think. So you're preaching to spiritual people. Let me read, I got one verse for a couple of things here. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 1, and I, brethren, could not speak to you as unto spiritual. And so there were some there that he could speak to as spiritual. But not only are there spiritual people there, but there's also the natural man. Now, the natural man, the spiritual man, is not going to give you much trouble if you feed him some. Then the natural man, until the Holy Ghost touches his heart, he's not going to give you any trouble anyway. The reason is, he don't care what you say. Doesn't matter to him until the Holy Spirit takes what you said and deals with that heart. So, what a task that I just set before us, that we have to preach to people that's got a Bible knowledge, that's got a Bible education, that knows what we're talking about, And then we're talking to people that knows nothing, and preaching of the gospel to them, that's foolishness. To the spiritual, it's food. To the lost man, the natural man, it's foolishness. And that's how he feels when he's sitting out there. Then there's a third one. Let me read the scripture about the natural man. You got these in your notes. 1 Corinthians 2:14 on page 1. And the same verse, and I, brother, could not speak to you as unto spiritual, that's wrong one, but the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for there are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. How can a natural man spiritually discern anything? But you got the other crowd that's spiritually discerning what you have to say. And again, I say these two folks won't give you a whole lot of trouble. The third man, the third group of people, he's going to give you some trouble, and that's the carnal man. Because the carnal man is saved. The reason I say that in 1 Corinthians 3:1, he says, and our brethren. And so he is considering them as saved people. And he said, and our brethren could not speak unto you, and our brethren could not speak to you unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. And he said, you haven't grown up yet. And that's what carnal are. You've got some folks in there that's mature. You've got some folks in there, this sounds strange, spiritually has not been born again. So you've got the unborn, and then you've got the mature, and here you've got the babies. So you've got this whole group. I just mentioned to you that I preach different into one group than I do the other group. But now what am I going to do? I've got all these groups together. My advice, and we're about to finish up this first segment, but my advice to you is to pray. Just pray, ask God to help you, give you discernment in the scripture, and it's amazing to me. I've prepared messages for the spiritual, and people get saved. I've prepared messages for the lost, and people get spiritually fed. I've prepared messages not for the carnal, and people get right with God. It's not you, and it's not me, and it's not what we do or what we don't do. If we're preaching under the unction and the power of the Holy Spirit of God, and if you're preaching any other way but that, then you're in trouble anyway. So make sure you pray, and make sure you've asked God to touch you. There are some things here about preaching that I want to look at. I'm going to read these to you. And the next segment, we've got a few minutes here. In the next segment, we're going to go into detail. 1 Timothy 1:12 said, and I thank Christ Jesus, our Lord, who hath enabled me, for that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. What a blessing it is that you've been put in the ministry. You didn't join up. You didn't go into it thinking that it's a good field to go into and a good profession. Why would anybody want to do that unless God had put a desire? I'm convinced that when God puts a desire in your heart to preach or to be a pastor or in the ministry, that nothing will ever, ever override that desire. You may do other things, but that desire there is more than anything else. And the only way that desire can get there is for God to put it there, because the things that preachers have to go through, no one has a desire to do that unless God put that desire in them. I thank God that God has put us into the ministry. Now, what did you do for God to do that? Well, you're faithful. What a blessing that is. I don't know you. Maybe I'll meet you sometime. Maybe at graduation, I don't know. But I do know that if you're called to preach, God found something in you faithful. And found you faithful in something, and therefore he put you into the ministry. And he said, I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who has enabled me. So much involved in that enabling, that making it possible for me to do the work of God. And so we're going to close out this segment. You take a break, and we'll come back to the next class, and we'll begin this. I want to look at when we come back, you have what it takes, but that's not enough. What God's given you, wonderful. That's God's part, but that's not enough to get the job done. Let us pray. We didn't pray at the beginning. We'll pray, and then we'll dismiss till our next class. Father, help us now. Guide us and direct us in all you have us to do. Thank you for this 30 minutes of class. I pray I said something. I'll be a help to somebody, Lord, in this introduction, and be a blessing to them. Help us, Father, do right, and we'll praise you for it. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.